Welcome to the Lindenwood Sports Network. I'm Neil Fischer. Joining me today from the Lindenwood Wrestling Team is head coach Jimmy Rollins. Coach, how you doing?
Doing well, thank you.
Thanks for joining us today. You're coming off a great year in 2018. Let's talk about it a little bit. What were your thoughts after the year?
Yeah, I thought as a staff, we've been looking to make progressions as a program in developing our athletes, bringing in the right people. And I think it was finally coming to fruition in a way. We had some Division I transfers, some guys we've had developed through the program for 3 or 4 years. You started seeing it all come together. And, it was a special thing. It was a belief in our program that we could achieve some great things. And they did well. You know, there's still a little gap that we need to close here to get where we really want to be. But, in all that, there's a belief and an enjoyment in the experience for our guys. And that's what we want. You know, we want to enjoy this process. It's difficult. It's long. So they want to enjoy it along the way. And I think our guys really did.
And did they take it all in when they got to the NCAA tournament? Because it's, for some people, it's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. For senior that's going, it's mm-hmm. his last shot at going to a tournament to get a championship. And for players like Carlos Chaquez, winning it. What's that feeling like being in the atmosphere of a national champion?
Well, it's enjoyable. You think about the road and the talks and all the workouts and everything else that he went through, and each individual does. You know, I think one thing we talk to our guys about is we're along on their journey. We're a part of their journey. We may be an asset to them, but we're a part of that journey. And that's a big message we always try to get across, because they have to put in the work. We talk about it. You know, as coaches, we try to push our athletes in the right direction. We got the best seat in the house. We watched them along in this journey, and watching Carlos do that was fun. You know, we never talked about being undefeated. Back in my mind, I know he is the whole time, and being recognized as an NCAA champion after all that work and the wrestler year in Division II was great. You know, it was really something special for him and our program as well.
And Carlos was named the D2 Wrestler of the Year.
Yeah.
How significant of an honor is that to hold?
Oh, I mean, the best, the Heisman Trophy of Division II wrestling. That's a special honor. And he deserved it. You know, the 125-pound class is extremely deep, defending NCAA champions in there and everything else. And he goes through the gauntlet and really in some tough, hard-fought matches, but somebody who controlled everything. There's peaks and valleys along the way on that journey, but to go through and do what he did in the field that he did it through was truly impressive.
And let's talk about this season a little bit. Coming into the season, sixth ranked in the NCAA polls, and then second in the GLVC. Moving into the GLVC the first year, getting second, do you feel like you have a target on your back, or is it widely known that throughout wrestling there's more of a common ground, unso like football or baseball?
Sure.
Or anything like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's rankings. They are what they are. You know, they're fun to talk to recruits about and things like that. They're things we don't really discuss. We may use it as a tool to push a guy. You know, hey, you're ranked number 3 behind him. You know, it's things that you may use in that way. But, we always talk about it. You know, it's what other people say and believe. So we try to stay on task on what we do, whatever opponents cross from us. Chach, I think Carlos says it very well. Last year was last year. You know, what's happening today, what's in front of me today, and that's the mountain that we have to climb. So that's really our approach to it as a staff and a program. It's nice to be talked about, sure, but all it is talk. So we got to earn it.
And Tanner Hitchcock was named GLVC Wrestler of the Week. So an honor for him. To be the first year and the first member of Lindenwood to be crowned the GLVC Wrestler of the Week, what's that like?
It was great. You know, it was really a cool honor for Tanner and our program. You know, first week of the year having our first representative in our first week in the GLVC. So, and Tanner's a deserving kid. You know, he beats a 2-time All-American in the finals last week and, had a great day, 5-0 on the day. And, he's a terrific sophomore for us, you know, so. It's great for him to have that honor, and we hope we get some more this year.
And so talk about the style of wrestling that Lindenwood has in the maturity of the players. Do you think the maturity grows after seeing what the team has done in the NCAA tournament?
Yeah, I think there's always more belief, more buy-in. I think that's one thing we've been developing. Our style, we always call our program the melting pot of wrestling. You know, we got kids from, you know, all over the country that come here to compete. Everybody's got a different style. What we try to do is add to that style a little bit. We're not going to change you. We're going to make you better. We're going to make you more proficient. And you know, and you're going to enjoy this along the way. The big thing we look for is a passion for the sport. You know, you got to love to compete. You got to love to be out there. You know, it's one-on-one. You may have your team behind you, but you are alone out there. And you have to be comfortable in a deep, dark place. And we always talk about bringing people to deep water, you know, and, you know, you got to be comfortable out there. So it's a unique sport in that regard. But, you know, when we're developing our athletes, we're looking for those guys that have a great mindset of a team. But also there's got to be some selfishness. You know, you got to be out there to put on a show and make sure the fans want to come back and put points on the board. So,
how important is it to have your team right behind you when you're out there all alone and you may get a big stop or make a big play and they get rowdy and all fired up for you and you hear them? What's that like?
It's an incredible feeling, you know, just to know when you can hear a pin drop almost. Everybody's waiting on your moment. You know, to see what you're going to do in that competition going on in our sport. So I like the rowdier the crowd, the better. I think that our guys enjoy that a lot. But really, it's the love. When our guys turn around, you know, they're not always looking at a crowd or anything else. They're looking at each other, their teammates, when they get their hand raised and everything else. It's about the next guy up. And our guys are really into that. So it's fun to watch.
You guys have started off the season very well. You guys are looking great. Like you coming off of an NCAA tournament and haven't lost anything. What are your thoughts on the season thus far?
Yeah, I mean, we're doing some pretty good things. I think we've had some underclassmen really develop maybe a little bit quicker than we thought. Some people still got a long way to go. You know, in our sport, it's a journey. It truly is, and it's a long one. You know, so you got to be prepared to climb that mountain, and everybody, and that's including our NCAA champions and our All-Americans. You know, they have to be prepared to start at the bottom and work up again. So it's always that. We try to, you know, one step at a time, one day at a time. But our guys handle it well. You know, we're dealing with some injuries right now early on in the year. So, you know, guys are getting opportunities in the lineup. It's about seizing that opportunity, making the most of it. To establish yourself as the guy and the guy who can compete and win matches for us at the NCAA tournament.
I know that the injury bug is not a thing you want as a coach or as a fan, but seeing kids be able to step up in those opportunities, fill those shoes, and see what they can do on the big stage, what's that like for a coach to be able to see what a kid can do that necessarily you didn't know he was going to get the opportunity?
It's big, you know. It's sometimes there's stylistic matchups in a program like wrestling where maybe a guy's better than another in our room, but maybe he can go out and perform better against other competitions. So we talk about seizing that opportunity a lot. That means every member of the team's got to control their diets and their weights, which is, again, something unique to our sport. But you might be the third guy on the depth chart, but we need you this week. So you got to be prepared to step up at any time. You know, it's different. I think our guys thrive in it. You know, it's not an enjoyable thing, I would think, all the time. But, you know, our guys understand that it's about everybody and it's about our team being successful. And each member of the program has a big part in that.
And does each member of the program hold everybody accountable for their actions? Say whether you eat a cheeseburger or a pizza and you're not supposed to eat that, you're supposed to eat a salad or something like that?
I'd say you hope that always as a coach. You know, when you're checking the scale, there's obviously some kids that may get away with some things every once in a while with some teammates. But, you know, we have great leadership. You know, Gavin Londoff is another guy that comes to mind. You know, he recently was yelling at his teammates saying, "You guys got to hold me accountable." You know, when you have a leader like that that wants them to make sure he's being pushed harder in the room and every day and things like that, you know you're surrounding your program with the right people. And he's wanting to get the most out of them, and so is all our leaders in our program. And it's contagious to young guys. You know, we got, I think it's 17 or 18 underclassmen in our program. So when they're seeing this example, you know, they're buying quickly. And they want to be the next one to be a Gavin or a Chach or a Danny Swan or anybody else that we have in our program. So it is big.
And you guys got a long season, one of the longest sports seasons in college. How do you guys stay in that mindset throughout the entire year?
Enjoy the moment. You know, it's you always understand that March is our most important time, but there is a journey along the way. There are steps that need to be taken. We talk a lot about, you know, training when others aren't. You know, that's a big mentality for me as an athlete and still as a coach is, you know, we got to do things that people may seem to think is a little crazy at times. And that may be, you know, getting up for our 6 a.m. lifts or doing multiple, sometimes 2-3 day workouts, you know, sacrificing the time out with friends or a cheeseburger or everything once in a while, you know. Those are the sacrifices that we make along this really long season to say, I'm prepared at the end. And when you do those things and you do the right things, usually you're coming out putting yourself in contention for those things. You still got to earn it. It's got to be a grit. But focusing on the mind as much as our body throughout this process, that's a big part of wrestling. You know, when you're not eating as many calories as most people, and you tend to be in a dark frame of mind sometimes. So you have to really manage that area. It's different, but there's a lot that goes into it. We're always working on we try to be around our team as much as possible, whether it's having them out to the house for get-togethers or just doing different things as a program.
You talk about earning things, and you earned a special award a couple weeks ago. You were inducted into the South Jersey Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
What's that feeling like being able to say that you're a Hall of Famer?
Yeah, it's nice, man. It really is. It was a great honor. You know, I grew up in southern New Jersey my whole life, and it's where my whole family still lives in a little 5-square-mile radius. So, you know, it's always home. It's happy to see the commitment that I've made throughout the sport kind of being honored in that way. You know, it's very humbling. You know, being up there with some of these guys, like I was telling you earlier, Olympic gold medalist and Jordan Burroughs, who you know, is in the pinnacle of our sport and world renowned, you know, just being back home, being around that, it's really fun. But it shows that there's still steps to take and more things to do as a coach. I still have to continue to earn those type of things. And I really try to put forth the effort, and I know my staff does as well, to show these guys that right direction that we want them to go.
When the student athletes see that you're inducted into the Hall of Fame in South Jersey for your efforts in wrestling, does that make their want and desire stronger to be the best?
I don't know about that. You know, I think each individual looks at everything differently. I think the one unique thing about college athletics and our sport in particular is sometimes this is the pinnacle for a lot of these kids. Competing at the NCAA level, you know, some of these guys aren't going to, you know, want to go on to Olympic dreams, and most of them won't. But a lot of them want to be around the sport. So it's about, you know, really seeing that, you know, your effort in this, you know, although we might not be, you know, a revenue generating sport as some would put them, you know, there's a lot of praise that you can get in this and to be a part of a special community.
And so what are you looking forward to in these upcoming weeks and months to get ready and prepare for the rest of the season?
Oh, getting healthy. You know, you want to be as healthy as we can throughout this, but really having fun. You know, when we're going to competitions, representing Lindenwood, our program, our alumni, in extremely high regard, competing at a physical level, going out to put points on the board, but really enjoying the process. You know, being on the road together, you know, it's always difficult to leave our families and leave our comforts of home here. But, you know, going out and enjoying it, you know, and taking it all in. You know, you only get to do this for so long. Not many of us make it a career, and I'm fortunate enough to do that, but these athletes, we want them to enjoy the process, have fun with everything, and again, just compete at the highest level they can.
And last year, quick question, Chris Beeney, the 10-year-old that was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, what has he meant to the program, and you guys go on to win, and what's the feeling like knowing that you guys support him, he supports you?
It's been great to get to know the Beeney family and Chris. You know, little things, being a part of you know, playing laser tag together, simple things, him coming to practice and dealing with all he has to deal with on a weekly basis, and the family in general. It was incredible here at Lindenwood to present them with their Make-A-Wish trip to Switzerland last year at the Roar Awards and everything else. You know, it's been incredible for us. I really enjoyed it. You know, Chris is always in a fight, and you know, he teaches us every day to just continue fighting, and you know, it's been great to get to know them. So
good.
We're hoping to see him soon.
Good. I look forward to the rest of the season. Yeah. That's all the time we have. Thank you to Coach Rollins for joining us, and best of luck along the way. Coming up next, we'll have the Lindenwood Field Hockey head coach, Sarah Baumann, after finishing her sixth winning season in a row.
They call me Prince like I'm royalty or something, but the places I've lived ain't no palaces. So I don't need grilled salmon or a new scratching post. Just give me a cardboard box and a can of tuna and we're good. You can even change my name. I'm cool being the kitty formerly known as Prince.
First time I tried Vicodin, it was laying around my mom's house. And then I kept taking them whenever I could get them. I didn't know they'd be this addictive. I didn't know how far I'd go to get more.
Opioid dependence can happen after just 5 days. Know the truth, spread the truth.
Welcome back to the Lindenwood Sports Network. I'm Neil Fischer. Joining me from the Lindenwood Field Hockey team is head coach Sarah Baumann. Coach, how you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks for joining us today.
Yeah.
Now, you went 11-7 this season, your sixth straight winning season. That's a remarkable stat for you.
Yeah, you know, it was a good year for us. I think we've had some kind of ebbs and flows this season, but anytime you get above 500 and have a winning season, you definitely take it and are pretty happy with the result.
Yeah, and it was kind of an up and down season throughout the way, but to come out on top and win your last game, there's no other better feeling than winning the last game, right?
Yeah, for sure. I think it's definitely hard. We lost to Bellarmine the night before, which was hard because we had already beaten them twice this year. But it's definitely nice for seniors and for returners even to know coming into next season that we ended with a win and we're kind of coming off a win going into the 2020 season.
And you guys played Bellarmine at the end of the season back-to-back. What's that like being able to play a team so many times throughout the year in such a short time?
Yeah, so it's hard for sure. I mean, I think it's hard mentally on the girls because you get those first two wins and you're really excited and you know that, you know, 5-6 days later you're going to be battling it out against that same team who, you know, at the end of the day is looking for some revenge against you. And so we always tell them it's really hard to beat a team three times, especially in one season, and especially that close together. And, you know, Bellarmine played a great game and they came out kind of guns blazing and they got the win that day.
And you guys went 500 on the road and on neutral fields, but 4-0 at home.
Mm-hmm.
What is the experience like playing at Hunter Stadium that makes it different on the road?
You know, I think that we have always, just like any team, really thrived off of being home. We only get a couple home games each season. So, you know, we had 18 games and only four of them at home this year. And so we want, you know, to make the most of it. It's nice to kind of be in your own bed the night before a game, be in your locker room to be able to kind of get hyped before a game and have that kind of home crowd. We had great support from other teams coming out and other general students. And so I think that helps a lot with that atmosphere.
And playing field hockey, it's not a Midwestern sport per se.
Yeah.
It's an East Coast style sport, and a lot of the teams you play are from the East Coast. What's it like being able to travel all the way out there to play against some of the best teams in the nation?
Yeah, I think it's an awesome experience. So it's always hard when you have to travel far for games, but we really try to use that as a selling point when we're recruiting, and even, you know, in the middle of season when it's kind of getting draining on players, that, you know, you come off a 5-day road trip and you come home for a day and you're on another 4-day road trip. But, you know, it's awesome to get to see a lot of different places across the East Coast. And it's also nice to be able to go into someone else's, you know, kind of home stadium and beat them there. And I think we kind of thrive off that. And know that, you know, no matter where we are, we can make it home away from home.
And last season, you guys went 12-3, went to the tournament. How hard is it to go to the NCAA tournament in field hockey and then win the national championship?
So last year we were 12-3, and we actually didn't go to the tournament last year. But we in field hockey, it's very hard because there's only 6 teams selected for the tournament, 3 from each region. And so to be top 3 in our region is extremely difficult. A couple years ago, we were 4th, and a year before that, we were 5th in our region. And so the competition of being in the Atlantic region is just super, super high. And so we're kind of on the brink of that. And I think that that's obviously one of our goals, is to stay in that top 10 and get into that top 3 within our region to go to that tournament.
And there were 6 seniors on this team in 2019. So how do you spin the wheel and get another great group of players to come in and kind of fill in their shoes and start all over from being a freshman?
Yeah, so it's always difficult. You know, last year we had a great group of 5 seniors that graduated, and it was one of those things where, how are we going to replace these seniors? And they had such an impact on the field and off the field for our roster. And then this year we come in, and, you know, you don't want to ever think that someone's replaceable, but people rise to the occasion and they end up filling those slots and those spots on the field and fill those leadership roles. And I think that we had girls that did that this year, and our senior class especially, our 3 captains really did that. And so I think we'll have people next year that rise to the occasion as well. And that's kind of the part of the growing process, as you kind of rise up in the ranks of being an upperclassman. I think, you know, we're losing our starting goalie and a couple of starting players, but that's just kind of the nature of sports. And, you know, you kind of have some seasons that go up and down. And when given the opportunity, I think we find that our athletes will really start to train and fight for those roles.
Let's talk about Bridget Hohendyke, because she's one of the seniors, and wow, what a season she put together. 16 goals. How many times have you seen that kind of performance throughout a season?
Yeah, I think it's unbelievable. You know, we've only had, I think, 1 or 2 other players that have really scored more goals than her in a season. But she just surpassed our all-time points for a career here at Lindenwood, and she well surpassed it, I think, with, you know, I think our other points were under 100, and now she's well over 100 with like 115, 18 or something points. So she's, you know, she's just got that knack for putting the ball in the back of the net. And I think she does a great job of tackling back on defense to win that ball for herself and her team, and is able to track with the ball, carry the ball well up the field past the teammates. And when she gets that ball in the circle, she just kind of knows where to aim it in the net.
So is her shot different than others on the team? Does she have a very unique style? Because she's not from the United States.
Right.
So the game overseas maybe played a little differently than in the U.S.
Yeah, the game is definitely played very different overseas. I think actually Bridget has done a great job adapting to the American style of hockey here, especially the Division II level. And I think that that's been really great for her, because she's able to keep the ball on her stick more. She knows she has less time in the circle to kind of do with it what she wants than she might overseas back home. And she's kind of done a great job adapting to that. So she's got a very wicked strong shot, and she knows when to release it and when to draw a corner instead. And she's really, really done a good job of adapting to that style over the last 4 years.
So has she handed that shot off to somebody that's going to be around on the team next year?
I hope so. I hope so. But, you know, when she takes a lot of those opportunities for herself, unselfishly, but those opportunities come for her, you know, I think next year when other girls on the team are given those opportunities, I think that, you know, they'll take them and start to, you know, find that they can score as well.
And so the culture you have at Lindenwood that you've built over 9 seasons is awesome. You guys have been very talented for the last couple of years.
Yeah.
And, I mean, 6 straight winning seasons, not many coaches get to say that these days, because there's so many talented teams around the nation. So what's it mean to you to be able to have that and know that Lindenwood Field Hockey is one of the top programs in the country.
Yeah, so I think it's really exciting. I think obviously it helps with recruiting, you know, being able to kind of use that as a selling point. But I think it really comes from the off-field culture that you build with your team. And we've been lucky to be able to get some really awesome, well-rounded young women in our program that come from really great families as well. So we have a really great family support system that travel with us to games. Our girls that are coming in and out of the program, you know, work hard off the field, work hard on the field. They really want to do well academically, and we have a really good team culture of accountability. So whether it's from us coaches or from their teammates, there's that accountability piece of, are you doing what Lindenwood Field Hockey is asking you to do, and are you representing our program at all times at the best? And if you're not, you probably won't be here 4 years. And if you are, you're going to find really great success. And I think that we've found those girls that want to be here for four seasons, and they've helped us get those six winning seasons, as well as, you know, really build that culture off the field too.
And it seems like when players graduate, they always stick around and contribute in some sense, whether it's just cheering the team on or being around the team off the field.
Yeah.
What's that like to know that it's not over after you graduate or after you get done with your 4 years playing? It still continues. You
right.
still have the friends and the teammates that you had.
Yeah. Well, you know, being an athlete here and stuff, it's so important for us to kind of bridge that gap, that once they leave here, we still want them to come back and contribute, whether it's being a fan or whether it's coming back for an alumni game. You know, our senior game this year, we had six alumni come and support us from three different alumni classes. And that just goes to show that hopefully it means that we're doing the right thing when they're here. We're building that culture that they really enjoy and want to take with them to other parts of their lives after they leave Lindenwood. And then they want to come back and support the young women that are kind of coming after them. They've kind of made their mark in their 4 years here, and they want to come support the ladies that are coming after them.
And so a quick look towards next season. I know it's early,
yeah.
but what are your thoughts on looking towards next season and the team that you have?
Yeah, so next year we're really going to be building our numbers. I think we had a smaller squad this year of only 19, and I think that we would really like to bring in a class of about 9 or 10. So with that, it's always fun and interesting and a lot of new members to kind of bring into that culture. But I think just like any season, you know, you lose a lot of great players and you think it might be a down year or a growing year for you. And I think if you do the right things and follow the right steps, it can really be another winning season for us. So it's just kind of about setting that tone with our returners this spring, making sure they're all on the same page to lead those newcomers next fall. And if that happens, I think great things can come next year.
Well, I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah,
thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
That's all the time we have. On behalf of Coach Rollins and Coach Baumann, I'm Neil Fischer. Thanks for joining us today.